cambia mucho a veces a scrims. En scrims juegas tu juego, aquí en el LCS tienes muchos nervios y a veces te vas de la partida, mentalmente te vas y no juegas como tienes que jugar bien. Yo llevo 3 años yendo a eventos y no sé qué y cosas y sigo teniendo los nervios. No sé si es ahora tengo nervios, pero no sé si es porque ya es la LCS, es Europa y no sé qué, o es porque nunca los voy a perder, no lo sé. O sea, yo creo que si llevo aquí un año, pues sí los perderé, supongo, o espero.
Welcome back to the European League Championship Series as we load up for our final match of the day between Giants and the first place SK Gaming. You just heard there from Giants talking about maybe being here in a year. It starts with picking up wins now. SK are coming home from a disappointing IEM performance, and while SK learned some very hard lessons, Giants were given a very clear roadmap on how to take down the European Titans. Let's quickly take a look at the team composition for the players for Giants. It is, of course, Werleb, Frederick, Pepinero, Audrey, Rydell, and Lothark, the coach. Yes, SK exposed Giants 2-8 versus top 6 teams. Can they pull off an upset win?
I mean, it is Europe, so yes, they can. But I would say on paper, no. SK Gaming should still be able to adapt to what Giants have been doing beforehand. They are a team who's struggling pick and ban phase. They are a team who's basically been relying on Pepinero to be the big carry for them. And also, when they play like the top teams, they've only won two. Well, teams above them only won 2 games, which is obviously nothing. But they are sitting down there in a bottom of the standings. Yep. MYM, for some reason, started winning games, making it even harder for Giants now to avoid relegation. They are, as we've said so many times, fighting to simply avoid it.
So, 2 things to keep note with Giants. Their schedule in the coming weeks is going to be relatively tough. They play SK today, Rocket tomorrow, Elements, and the Wolves. This is a difficult set of games. And if Giants lose today, they'll be tied with MYM. Whereas if they win, they will then be tied with Rocket and remain ahead of MYM. Yeah. It's interesting to note that if Giants lose, in the head-to-head, they're 1-1 against Micho Maker, so it will force a tiebreaker at the end of the split.
And it really is the thing, if you look at that schedule here, so Elements just picked up a win against H2K.
Yeah.
So suddenly you should really take them serious. It's Rocket that's going to matter for them tomorrow. SK Gaming here, again, if you are Giants and you look on paper and say, okay, which games do we have to win? It's not exactly the SK Gaming one, unless there's still some problems after IEM, new patch, less time to practice, the upset, it can happen.
Well, let's take a look at the roster on the red side of the Rift tonight. It is SK Gaming, who have returned from that recent trip to Poland, Freddy, Sven, Fox, Forgiven, and Rated, and Inner Flame, the coach. We've touched on how they need wins to avoid the tiebreaker with H2K or Fnatic. This is SK as a team. They've already beaten Giants in week 4. And if we look at SK as a team, we've touched the mistakes and the weaknesses that were exposed by the international squads at Intel Extreme Masters.
Yeah, it was very clear there, hey, we need to win our laning phase to get a dominant early game strategy from SK. We're very easy to exploit. Teams simply banned them out. Forgiven, obviously, was banned out quite a lot. And honestly, new patch, Freddy and Svenskan has never been the big tank players, per se. That's a lie on Freddy, sorry, because he used to play a lot of Mundo. But Svenskan, at least, never really been the big tank here. Will he adapt to that kind of style? Will we see Forgiven change up his champion pool? Because the likes of Graves against two tanks is not going to do a whole lot late game.
No, it's not. Let's actually look at that recipe to defeat SK Gaming, as was so clearly exposed. It was the Graves being banned away. It was the Lucian being banned away. And the Lulu taken away from Enrated. You remove those 3 things, all of a sudden, SK Gaming are at a loss. 1-2 because Enrated's Annie was weak and Forgiven didn't have the same impact on Corki.
No, it was very clear they hadn't practiced enough with these new kind of champions, but again, they have had some time now. They've obviously known this is going to happen at some point. The big difference, however, is that Giants as a team, do they have the players to punish SK Gaming no matter what composition they do pick? Because if you look player for player, only in the mid lane is where we can say it's somewhat even, because Pepinero has been a big star player for Giants, but that's not even a winning matchup for them. And suddenly, you can't really punish just by banning these 3 champions. Yeah. And obviously, a lot of new picks coming in. Suddenly, every team is trying to figure out their own style. It is still tough for Giants.
It is very tough. And you know, something that SK have always done is won that lane and then they end up winning the game. At IEM, they were behind in 2 out of those 3 games and proceeded to lose them. In the LCS, they've only been behind in gold at 20 minutes in 4 out of the 14. And actually, they managed to win 3. So it's quite interesting to keep track of that. SK and their strength in the laning phase. Deficio,
okay.
We are into picks and bans.
Already a change.
Zed removed from Fox, and it seems to have maybe tricked or confused SK for a moment.
Well, this is simply again because Giants is trying to get Pepinero a good matchup in the mid lane, because he's going to be the guy they want to carry. Graves is coming in. I wonder if Lucian is going to be the next one from Giants or Lulu against Enraider, but we still see Graves being banned. I think Forgiven has been playing a lot of different champions now. I don't even think he minds that Graves is being banned away, because it is really the whole we got to win early game if you pick Graves now with his mid game into double tank. But we're going to have to see. Rek'Sai is open for Frederick. He's been a Jarvan main beforehand, but obviously Jarvan has fallen quite far down the list after his recent nerfs. Rek'Sai, if that doesn't get locked in here, I will still assume Svensken to pick it up for himself. And we know he can make the plays early on, despite him having a pretty awful IEM tournament, honestly. He admitted himself he didn't play well, and that was one of the reasons SK Gaming lost.
Well, we'll see what SK can do today. We looked at that recipe to beat SK. Two out of three ingredients followed here by Giants, with the Graves and Lucian been removed. First pick, we are expecting it to be this Rek'Sai.
Oh yeah, there's no Jax.
If not, you could go for that tank top. Wonder how Jax would do in the current meta. Will it? This might be the first game in many that Jax is available.
Yeah, I like that he doesn't first pick it at least. The problem is, however, Whirlip, while he looked good in the start, that was because people got surprised that they would camp the top lane. And that's not going to happen anymore. So I don't even think Jax is going to be a good pickup for him, per se. I think you would rather put him on a big tank instead. Because we've seen how if a top lane has been struggling, if you give him the likes of a Maokai, not in this case because SK might pick it away, he can do pretty well. And then your two carries are still going to be Pepinero and Atri. We have to see if they want to go for this Jax. I mean, you can do it into Maokai, you can force a split push, but you got to snowball that Jax early on. And if SK Gaming does not expect that, then it's their own fault.
Well, Tificio, this is the 15th game Giants have played on the stage. Jax has been banned in 12. The first two games it wasn't banned. Giants went 2-0. We will see. You have already highlighted the strengths and weaknesses. Freddy, not a weak top laner. He's got his hands on Maokai, one of two big tank champions for the front line if they want to go that route. And Fox, same mid lane champion that Ryu just ran previously.
And while Maokai obviously, or well, while Freddy has been mainly focused on lane bullies, we know he used to play a lot of Mundo. We know he can play the tanks. He can play these different styles. So Maokai's going to fit in fine for him. We got LeBlanc. Often, as we see when Zed is being banned away, LeBlanc doesn't really have any counters left. And then you can just safely pick it. SK Gaming is a team who likes to do it, even first picked it in the past. We are going to see the Jax. Now, will SK Gaming here, they already locked in Maokai, so that simply means step one, we might see a lane swap coming, because you don't want that one-on-one lane where the Rek'Sai is going to be a lot stronger than whatever Svensken is going to pick. If he goes for a tank like Sejuani in the jungle for him, then SK Gaming again really is going to look for that swap and slow down the Jax. Don't allow the Maokai to be camped.
Well, it'll be important to see if Giants were paying attention to IAM, because SK Gaming in the traditional lane swap pushed those towers quickly. And Tificio, you highlighted multiple times when teams froze the lane against Freddy, denied him early farm, it gave their opponents such a strong lead, a strong foot up in the game. For SK, they've locked in Nami, they've locked in Lee Sin, despite the fact Lulu was available.
Well, you do see here that SK Gaming is adapting to, okay, you got a Jax, we know you're gonna camp it, so we pick Lee Sin, a very strong early game jungler as well. No tank yet for Svensken, and I quite like this Nami pickup from Enraider just because it's not Lulu. That's the main reason. He's played Nami once before, he had a fairly decent showing. It's a good pick into the likes of Jax, because if Jax tried to join a fight, you tidal wave him, you can bubble him after, and the way to shut down a Jax in teamfights is just CC him. There's nothing else he can do. Once he jumps in with Leap Strike, his mobility is gone. So just lock him down and he won't do anything to your carries. So obviously Giants are looking mainly for split pushing. If they do lock in Jinx here, you're going to need a static shift to become a bit of a wave clip bot in the mid lane. But they have a lot of peel now for Atri in this case. So you got a 1-4 setup from Giants here. You got peel, protection from the Morgana, from the Lulu. You got the late game hyper carry. You got decent wave there through Jinx with the static shift potentially. And of course, the Lulu, while Frederick will do, or Willy will do all the work on Jax in the side lane.
All right, we'll see how Giants can handle themselves. A lot of ingredients here that could cook themselves up a very, very strong mid to late game. Can't afford to fall behind too far in the early stages, especially against the Lee Sin and LeBlanc from SK.
All right, different style. So Forgiven taking Tristana, an AD carry which is the complete opposite of what he normally plays. Tristana is not very strong in the laning phase anymore, especially not after her changes. She needs to get that BF sword, she needs to get some AD to make her E really strong and get in towards the mid game instead. So SK Gaming, with their setup here, if they do lane swap, you get to shut down the Jax a little bit, and also you get Tristana to get to a BF sword point with if you fast push the lane. Then you swap down to the 2-on-2 lane where Nami and Tristana can become a good lane.
Yeah, and also important to note, the way SK likes to push early towers, Tristana's going to be fantastic
at
that.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Get the explosive charge on, get some early tower damage. So we'll see whether or not SK Gaming can make an impact in this laning phase. They've given Wurlib Jax. Is Wurlib's Jax enough to unseat the number one team in the standings in Europe?
This is the game that will show it, because again, it's been banned so many times against them. Once we go back to standard lanes, so if we're going to be standard lanes, we know Frederick is going to go to that top lane. It's going to happen. Sven should be ready for it, have a few early wards, be ready for a potential counter gank. It's not like Jax is fantastic in the early levels. No, he needs time, he needs Trinity Force, he needs Blade to become really, really strong.
Well, you're about to see the team comps, guys. As per usual, lock in your votes. Who do you feel will pick up a win here? Will it be Wurlib on Jax with the rest of the Giants? Or is it going to be SK Gaming after we see Forgiven on a new champion in the European LCS? As we load up into game. I'm interested to see how the lane swap plays out. You feel that SK would be looking for it, and we'll see whether or not Giants will let them have it or play around it or play to counter it. A lot of options and decisions to make earlier.
Yeah, I mean, it's not the end of the world if they don't get the lane swap, because you can set up some fairly easy ganks on a Jax with the Maokai. So it's more just, if you look at the way we know Giants wants to play, that's a way of shutting it down. And we also know Tristana wants to get to a BF sword, which is what Forgiven always does. That's why he fast pushes the wave and takes the tower, so you can back with around 1600 gold, get that BF sword, then he swapped down to the 2-on-2 lane, so Tristana can do it for him. And as you mentioned, she's fantastic at pushing towers in the late game especially, when you put your E on the tower. Now he might have to be a little bit careful.
Oh, Audrey is going to look Forgiven forced to have an early flash. And that's going to give up a lot of lane presence if Forgiven has to play defensively.
That's pretty good scouting though by Giants. Whenever you see teams have someone walking in the lane, hug the bush here and then move towards this small bush in the river, that's because you know or you expect the enemy to have someone standing there waiting, and then you try and force a summoner like they just did here. We get the ward on the Grump, as we've talked about so many times today, to spot if the dual lane is starting it. It does look like SK is setting up for that standard lane. Obviously, Nami is a fantastic laner. Should make up for some of the weakness of Tristana, and let's see how the two junglers then will play around it.
And we'll see which lane gets rolling first. We can expect Frederick to show his face with Wurlib. Pepinero takes a little bit of a larger chunk of damage than Fox in that particular trade. No big surprises as far as itemization is concerned. Wurlib with a very defensive flask sustained start. The little Raptors secured by Freddy. So he'll get himself to a early level 2 once he hits that top lane.
Wurlib is always doing Raptor camp himself though when he's playing Jax, so he gets instant level 2 because he does the whole camp as we can see here. Then he recalls and teleports back to the lane. So he's gonna get that instant level 2, but if Freddy can get a few minions down, he might be able to catch up before Wurlib can do anything, because he obviously wants to TP to the tower as well. And we can see Freddy's gonna get the small minions here. And once he gets one more ranged, he will be fine. So no real surprise for him once Wurlib shows himself. And a TP advantage very early on now for SK.
Oh, look at that. Caught by the Flame Chompers and caught by the Dark Binding. Archery and Rydal. Some early poke damage onto Forgiven. And that's actually a very scary CC chain that can be comboed one after the other if Rydal can be on point with those skill shots.
Another thing about this bottom lane here, I think for SK Gaming, they say we don't really care what you have in the bottom lane, because we know we can outplay Audrey and Rydal, who's not been one of the strongest laners, honestly. So SK Gaming, we see it already, pushing it in, get a bit of damage on the tower with the Tristana. You can still do your 1-3-1 setup, where you just have Forgiven in the mid lane. You put, obviously, the Maokai with the TP in one lane, and you put, as they always do, your Assassin in the other side lane, and you just push up these lanes. So they can play exactly the same style, despite having a different AD carry. Just less early pressure from Forgiven. He needs more time before he's going to be relevant in the game, and that's where we're going to have to see the change.
Well, on the bright side, the fact that Audrey's playing Jinx also means there's going to be that sort of I don't want to use the word dip, but it's going to be a slower scaling ramp up, I think is a more appropriate phase. We'll see who can make use of that. Fox jumps onto Pepinero, misses the ethereal chains. Passive gets pop. Peppy is looking for the kill. He flashes forward. Auto attack will give him first blood. But Sven with the reply, and Pepinero with the outplay of Fox in the mid lane.
Look at the top lane though here. Freddy might be in trouble. They're trying to force his flash at least. Frederick, can he get it?
Well,
yeah, there we go.
Doesn't need it. No flashes blown from Whirlip or from Frederick. And Giants with the early aggressive plays coming out a little bit ahead.
And the same setup as always with the Jax. Obviously, Pepinero trading his own life here for killing. The one at the mid lane, forgiven. Jumping in. I mean, Rylan Audrey here. Not that Jinx and Morgana is not exactly the best lane itself in the early game. And really, just because of this Nami pickup, SK Gaming have been able to take fully control of it from Arid, and of course, forgiven also being such a good laner.
You do see the CS advantage building up as well. Forgiven and Enrated taking advantage of these first 5 minutes. Forced Audrey and Rydal to back away and play super, super defensively. And of course, Fox, no flash in this middle lane. So let's keep that in mind if Frederick wants to sniff around, and it looks like he does. Fox is going to clear out Vision in the bottom half of the map. You can see Sven moving towards that area. And the Wolf Camp to clear out, as well as Gromp in a moment or two.
So it seems like the strategy from SK is going to be focused on the bottom side instead of, you know, warding up for Freddy top lane, because that Pink Wolf was placed down towards the Dragon from them, and Svenskan also took the route down towards the Dragon when he ganked the mid lane. No way of trying to spot Frederick. So Freddy just has to play really careful in his lane. See, Enrated here. No binding from Rydal yet, but Freddy just needs to sit back and not do anything in this lane, because they're not warding for him at the moment. Now Svenskan is moving in, trying to spot it up. There's a Pink Ward now on the top side placed by him. Okay, so they have Pink Wards on both sides. We're trying to see, okay, where's Frederick moving? Can we stop him from getting into our jungle and obviously get up towards the top lane?
All right, we'll see what decisions those wards work out for. We do see Rydal roaming on the minimap to help out Pepinero, but Fox, is he going to decide to go in? No, because the Black Shield revealed Pepinero had support, but Pepe's really trading very, very aggressively with Fox. It's not costing CS, despite the fact that Pepe's forcing Fox to go on the back foot.
Right, but Lulu is a good pick into the bunk because you can just basically sit back and shield yourself and farm. Now, Rydal is still here.
Doesn't connect, but Pepe's going to chase. He's got the movement speed. One more Glitter Lance. Wild Growth is going to slow Sven, and Sven's going to ward hop. We do see him forced to flash away. Giants, 2-1. The roam from Rydal pays off, and it's going to give Giants a little bit of time to get damage on this middle lane. It's a decent start, and it's getting Lulu to the...
Oh, it's a great start.
...the mega utility position Giants wanted to be in.
The stronger, obviously, the Lulu is going to be, the better your mid-game will be, and also the shields you're going to provide, the Whimsy scaling so well with AP. But this is really just SK Gaming playing over-aggressive in their mid lane, not respecting Pepinero and the damage he can do early on in the laning phase, and that's why they get punished for it. It is a good matchup again for Lulu. But it's not one where you're supposed to get 2 kills.
Yeah,
like, it's supposed to just be a farm lane. You basically force the bank to get a farm lane where she doesn't really have a lot of pressure because you can always shield yourself and, like, trade back. That's what Lulu does normally. And therefore, you kind of nullify the assassination potential of a LeBlanc. But now, 2 kills. This is looking great, suddenly, for Pepinero.
Yeah, actually, very low amounts of farm between those mid laners thanks to the fairly high number of trades between the two of them. Fox, 39 to 40. Despite maybe underestimating Pepinero, is still staying close on the last hitting, but obviously the additional gold from the kills is going to work into Pepe's favor. A matchup that we've not looked at all is Whirlip and Freddy up top. Whoa, Fox is feeling the pressure and just goes all in on Pepe. Once his ultimate comes back up with Ignite, yeah, Pepe should have well got it. It's going to be an interesting one.
He's trying to bait it now. He knows there might be another attack. So Frederick is sitting inside. Finskan again showing him. There's still that Pink Ward on the top side at least for them. Red takes quite a chunk of damage. Both junglers around the mid lane. Instead now Frederick looking towards the top side. There's no flash for Freddy. Diving him is going to be a bit tricky, especially because Whirlip only sits on double Doran, so that should not be the strategy for them. Also spot Frederick, so as soon as they see Frederick here, and okay, he's going to sit and wait. Svenskan goes down to the Dragon. You know the top laner is on the top side. Yes, Frederick has ulti, so you can try and come down and stop it, but they have to move in now.
Well, let's see what they do. Dragon to less than half hit points. Forgiven is responding. There's a numbers advantage here for SK. They're grouped up. Frederick has committed. has managed to dodge the Aqua Prison and should be able to take the tunnel out. Early Dragon to SK, very smart play, and also got the Void Rush from Frederick. So
yeah, just a little bit too easy.
A little bit of breathing.
A little bit too easy because Frederick showed himself on the top side with the ward. Obviously, he was trying to get a bit of extra gold, but still, when you show yourself there and you know there's no threat of your top laner diving, it's very safe for you to just start that dragon. Because worst case, if Giants try and collapse, you just back out around your own blue buff and you just walk away from it and you didn't really lose anything on the side of SK. So an easy dragon for them. Freddy still farming pretty well despite losing that early flash. Slightly ahead of the Jax pickup for Whirly. So SK game been happy doing standard lanes.
Yeah, 9 minutes on the clock for Given, still with a small CS advantage. If we actually take a look at the gold that he's got to spend, sitting on 1600. So got enough for that next BF sword. Audrey a little bit behind at 1360 for the time being. So if Forgiven can, when he eventually gets the next back, we'll be able to have that big spike in damage. It's what Tristana's looking for.
And it's already a change in style from SK because they don't really have any straight of winning lanes. And that's why they're not able to fast push down any towers in this standard setup, which is so different from when they play Graves and they play all in the laning phase. When, you know, they try to get kills in the mid lane, they have a strong laner in the top lane, that's where they pressure all the towers. They're not doing it this time around, they're just farming. They're happy just sitting back and waiting for a few items before they start making the plays. Svensken is now sitting here, he's hoping for Frederick to show himself in this top lane. So you now have the option of counter ganking, or if Whirlip goes in for any kind of farm, you can obviously kick him back on the Lee Sin.
Well, we'll see between these two junglers, as you mentioned. Svensken's Lee Sin got that warrior enchant on the Trailblazer completed a moment ago. Skirmishers got upgraded to Warrior there by Frederick. Let's see if he can run amok and cause a nuisance in Forgiven's face.
Okay, so we do see for Frederick, he's aiming to split push. It's the only reason for that Skirmisher Saber for him. So obviously you use your ulti as your TP and you set up for a 1-3-1 setup instead for Giants instead of the 1-4 we mentioned earlier. Because obviously Frederick wouldn't add a whole lot of value sitting in the mid lane. He just doesn't really provide anything. So instead, just having him in the side lane, so the skirmisher is just going to make him a bit stronger in the one-on-ones. Otherwise, I'm going to do a whole lot else for him if he doesn't use it in split pushing.
Well, we'll see if Frederick can make that work. 1-3-1, a recipe for success. SK leading up to week 7 of the LCS before IEM happened. Rydal's going to get a dark binding onto Forgiven, but the rocket jump had already started channeling, so he gets away. We see Whirlip going in on Freddy. Vengeful Maelstrom is being channeled. He gets stunned by the counter-strike. He pops the Maelstrom. Ends up trading a little bit evenly, but I think sustain somewhat in favor of Maokai, especially with that extra armor.
And once we get a BF sword on Forgiven, that's where we can start seeing SK Gaming make some plays. You really need that one of those first items, or almost the first item completed beforehand, but you don't want to wait too long because against the Jinx and the Jax going late game, that's very, very scary for them. So we need the BF sword on Forgiven, and then I would like to see Svensson come down to the bottom lane, fast push in the lane in a 3v2, and just start poking down his tower here with the Tristana. Create a power play that way. He's once again on the top side. Frederick now moving in behind Frederick, Freddy, spotting Svensson now with the Tremor Sense. Frederick and Freddy.
Yeah, I know.
Brothers, man.
It messed me up once already. We'll see if Frederick can find Freddy. In fact, he's turned his attention to Fox in the middle lane. Fox gonna dash away. Sven with the flash forward. Tries to get the Dragon's Rage kick and actually knocks Frederick to safety. We do see Pepinera in a running low on Mata. And Sven and Fox unable to make a kill. But oh, super mega death throw.
Thank you, observers, for following that. That was awesome. Hey, remember, this mid tower, tier 2, doesn't give a shield anymore. That would have saved him. He just died from it. Thank you, Patchnose 5.5.
Rito, please, costing Fox a death. And now Frederick plus Pepper Nero take down the first tower of the game. Give Giants a small gold lead. And with a kill from downtown, Audrey is going to be sitting pretty. Giants making the more aggressive plays. And it's mostly been centered around Pepper Nero.
It's all been about Pepper Nero in the mid lane, winning his lane matchup. That's also why Freddy could go for a fairly aggressive dive from the from obviously SK Gaming's Raptor camp. And still no, even in a 2v2 right now, we're going to be stronger because Pepper Nero had such a great start to the game. See, there's a whole blasting one on the head at this point. So Dragon in about a minute's time. SK Gaming is setting up for it again, but it's not like they're in a super strong point here because they've given up a few kills. And you can see both top laners. Oh, well, Freddy won't have his ready in time. Yeah, Svenskan again looking for this top lane gank. Yes, okay, Maokai can set up really easily, but he's spotted. He's going to get baited into this one.
Yeah, Tremor Sense is revealing Svenskeren's position.
Is
looking for the fight. Look at the minimap. Rydal's gone over the wall. He gets booted backwards. Sven is trying to get away with his life. Now Fox, we see on the background. First victim is going to be Svenskeren. Now Fox is in full retreat. Freddy is on the hunt with Frederick. And we do see Freddy jumping onto Whirlip. 3v1. Freddy's going to get dropped. Pepe Nero 4-1-1. They get two kills, but lose a tower in exchange, meaning SK is still keeping themselves relevant.
They can push him for next one as well.
Yeah, pushing that bottom tower, DeFicio. I think Tristan's going to do a lot of damage to it.
Those four guys set into the top lane. You can never leave a Tristan alone near your own towers. He will destroy them already. But yeah, we saw the bait again. The Tremor Sense doing work for Frederick here to spot Svenskeren. But then was a 4v3 up there in the top lane. And yes, it was a few kills for Giants, but losing that bot lane tower and potentially losing control of the dragon as well. None of the kills went over to your Jax. Right now, you need your kills to go to your carries.
Yeah.
Yes, Lulu is fine, but you want the Jax to get the kills. Frederick, he's going in.
Does not manage to get the knockup. We see the Flame Chompers coming down. Audrey is going to secure the crab in favor of Giants. Whirlip is going to reply to the bottom turret kill by taking out the top tower. Remember, Freddy's TP was slightly delayed, but it is now available. And you can see Freddy moving up top. Whirlip still sitting on a lot of gold, 2,300 to be exact. And we'll see him backing to pick up some items. And the rest of Giants grouped around. They're going to have vision of this dragon. We'll see if they want to start the fight, DeFicio.
Well, they do have the minions pushing for them, SK, so they have knowledge of Jinx being down there. But Giants, they're moving in. It's only right here at the moment. So they're giving up the second dragon. Will they try and fight?
They're looking for it. Look at Pepe Nero.
Sneaking from behind. Oh. Misses the little lens. First one.
First one. I'll give him that one. Trinity Force complete for Whirlip on that last back. Giants, a little disconnected maybe. They were obviously going to be late to the dragon anyway, and they were unable to find SK Gaming for a follow-up team fight. So SK, dragon number two at 15 minutes, still on set for a relatively early five dragons if they maintain control. But you have to feel they're not going to have that many easy ones in the coming minutes.
I think Giants just wanted to play it safe here. They didn't want to risk anything because they're doing well in terms of the laning phase. Now onto Freddy, no flash.
Wow, that's a Trinity Force Jax that's running down
Ryan Malkar. Ryan is nearby as well.
Despite the frozen heart, Freddy is staying alive and gets dropped after one more leap strike. Giants with another kill and what looks to be another tower, accelerating their gold lead, DeFicio, to about 4,000 after this is dropped. Giants, we remember the recipe. Ban Lucian, ban Graves. Is it enough?
It really just seems like SK Gaming doesn't really know what to do at this point because they haven't won their lane phase so hard. Well, I guess Forgiven knows what to do. But when it comes to that top lane here, when you play against Giants and you give them Jax, you have one job. Don't let them get any early kills. Just move back to your own tower. Let them push in that wave. Deep ward or place wards in your own jungle on the top side around your own red buff. So if he's moving from the lane down to the mid lane, you're going to see him move at least. And just make sure you never get caught out, at least when you don't have a summoner like Freddy here and die. So SK Gaming, they got the bot lane tower, but that's it. They haven't won the laning phase, otherwise lost the mid lane. They've been losing the top lane lately as well. And this is basically where SK Gaming normally has no clue what to do, cannot use the 1-3-1 split push, and ends up getting forced into team fights. In this case, if Giants keep playing like they do, that's not going to go well for SK.
So we'll find out if SK can bounce back. DeFicio, he sound a little bit uninspired at the possibilities. We are only 17 minutes in the game. And just as an interesting note, for SK, when they've been behind at 20 minutes, they've lost three games. When they've been behind at 20 minutes. I made that statement in the previous matchup. Just before 20 minutes, H2K's lead was obliterated. We have 2 minutes left in this one. Let's see if SK can make a power play. And also, look at all the tunnels for Frederick in the top half of the map. It's very clear where he wants to
respond. Oh yeah, for sure. I think it was very clear for everyone before the game even started, before the picks came in, where his focus would be. So it simply means he can go bottom lane now, start split pushing that in the 1-3-1 setup, and he can always join on the top side if any fights happens. And SK Gaming, when they look to stop that split push, it's not by going and killing the Rek'Sai, because the Rek'Sai itself is not really doing too much. So you want to just let him push in the wave and then force a fight somewhere else. And that's why where these tunnels can be very helpful for Freddy, because it's going to be the Jax you're going for. He's the guy who can destroy your towers extremely fast.
SK Gaming at 11-3, only marginally ahead on the public poll against a team that is currently 4-10. But Given does get caught out. Rydal doesn't connect with the Dark Binding. Buster Shot knocks Frederick away. Soul Shackles will keep for Given in place, and Audrey will secure the last hit. Set that one up. SK respond with a three-man push in the
TP
middle
behind,
lane.
Yeah.
Look at Wurlip. He's teleporting behind them. This will become a 2-on-3. TP from Freddy to join the fight. Now it's a 4-on-2. And with the numbers advantage and the TP for TP, SK again trade kills for a tower.
That was a good trade by SK Gaming, and somewhat back to the standard style they do have, where they leave at least a pressure in two lanes at once. So in this case, it was the mid lane with the members, so as soon as you saw three guys bottom lane, you just push it in and take a tower. So good response from them. Giants really wanted to make this play. Sadly, Pepinero just gone back to base to complete his death cap. Had he been in the mid lane already to clear the wave, that would have been a perfect play from them to punish Forgiven for sitting and farming with no tower to go back to. But just a little bit of a missed timing with Lulu being back in base when they go three bottom lane.
Yeah, and I like the opportunistic play from SK, making sure that once they had that numbers advantage, it's something they actually do relatively well. When one of their top or bottom lanes
they always do well, yeah. Always.
You know, they respond with, in theory, one of the best scenarios. So you do see some vision being put in place in the Dragon Pit, some relatively defensive wards, I think, from SK in the mid lane. And it looks like Giants should be able to clear out the river to set themselves up for the next Dragon. It's a minute 10 away. And Giants have not secured either of the two previous Dragons.
Oh, but you do have a mid laner who is ahead at this point. These shields is going to do a lot. And even the damage of Lulu, you have to respect it. Only problem is, a Maokai is going to do a lot more than a Jax in a 5-on-5 team fight. So obviously Giants are not looking to really force anything here. But they might have to simply because the two Dragons already has been picked up by SK Gaming. Ideally, you just wanted your Jax to sit and split push. No TP, however, so Freddy will be able to push his wave in and walk down towards the Dragon. And this is the way SK Gaming can do really well. You got an item advantage on your AD carry. You have a massive top laner who's been getting a lot of farm. This might not be what Giants is looking for.
It just feels like Giants have been dawdling a little bit. They moved in to put some vision into the jungle of SK. 15 seconds before Dragon is up, you see Audrey pushed out that bottom wave, and the rest of Giants dancing on the crab movement speed. Wurlip actually leaped onto Sven as the Dragon spawns. Now, SK, do they want the full 5-on-5 versus the very, very scary Lulu? That will be the question.
Yeah, look at the position here from Giants. They push your bottom wave, so if they win the fight here, they can go straight bottom lane and take another tower. So SK Gaming have to be careful, but they're going in for this one.
So Freddy jumps onto Frederick with a twisted advance. We do see once again the tidal wave is now thrown down. Here comes Frederick from the side. Dragon's down to 2,000 hit points. Frederick kicked to the back line. The Giants are one man down. SK Gaming continue to fight as the wild growth is thrown onto Wurlip. Forgiven forced a rocket jump to safety. Dragon has not fallen in and amongst the chaos, but a lot of key ultimates used from Giants. SK, do they want more? We did see the Mega Death Rocket flying by and hitting nothing. Look at the middle lane. Forgiven's pushing out. Wurlip, he's leaped over the wall. Dragon secured by Giants, but it was a clip to Lancer Dillard. Now Wurlip in the skirmish scenario, looking for a target, and Sven's going to use that Ranger's Trailblazer again. Tower falling in favor of SK despite losing the objective. You see Forgiven are trying to get away. That's a good bubble from Enrated. Wurlip, the bomb's gonna pop in a moment. He leaps forward with flash over the wall from Forgiven, and Frederick, he wants more. The Unburrow doesn't connect. Flash forward into the bite. Forgiven still alive. Rooted in place by Freddy onto Frederick. He's down. And an over-aggressive play from Frederick,
yeah,
gives a kill to SK.
He unburrowed too early, so he flashed after. There was no knock-up on Forgiven there. So didn't end up killing. But Audrey, we talked about that wave beforehand. Moved down and managed to pick up that tower while Forgiven got the mid lane. Bit of a weird fight from Giants. One guy going in first, then the other guy joins in once he's dead already. It was a good play by SK though, kiting back to single out the jungler. It's one of the things about Rek'Sai is you tend to be building for your team where you get sidestone, you get locket and so on, so you don't really become that tanky, which means once you go in, teams just focus you and just burn you down extremely fast.
A lot of props to SK. Every time they're under pressure, every time Giants are being proactive and setting up ganks or pushing one lane, SK have responded with a tower. It's 4 towers to 3. And that gold lead that was, you know, quite sizable 10 minutes ago is now becoming slightly less relevant.
True.
But the scary thing for SK, how do they handle a Jax that's been relatively uncontested for 25 minutes?
I mean, Giants can be happy, honestly, with that trade beforehand. Even though you gave up a tier 2 mid tower, just by stopping SK from getting to the third dragon and potentially the fifth one, that was like all they did. So they decided to say, we don't mind losing a tower just to get that first dragon on the board. And now we're going back to split pushing. TP is ready, ulti is ready for Frederick. He should go down to side lane himself, just at least to pick up some farm. He might just be the wave clear bot. He goes down, clears the wave, joins his team again, not really looking to do too much aggressive pushing at this point for himself. But still, he has the skirmishes for it. He's not really been using it for anything else. But
it's that 1-4 push you touched on during picks and bans, DeFizio. You can see with teleport, Whirlip is up in the top lane. Look, there's a teleport here from Freddy. It's going to come in behind Giants. Fox is looking for Frederick, but the Black Shield's going to keep him alive for a moment or two longer. Audrey is able to sidestep the Tidal Wave, but Rydal's been jumped onto. Soul Shackles is going to keep Svenskeren and Freddy in place as Rydal forced to flash away. Keep your eyes on Whirlip. What can Whirlip do? We see Enraged is going to be actually getting away. It was Rydal that's dropped. Now Freddy being focused down. Jax out of the fight means SK leap forward. The rocket jump forward. The bomb's going to blow up. Frederick is down, and SK win a convincing team fight, 0-3.
It's, oh, well, I guess we can't one
for
kill.
Three, 1-3.
But it's the kind of the same deal again for Giants here. They're going like one by one, and one guy's dead, the other guy joins in. Don't really find any success in these fights here. Baromir's out there very low, but Peppernell has already shown himself in the bottom lane. I think Giants could have gone to stop this with Jinx and Lulu together, or at least made it a lot harder for SK.
Baron secured, and all of a sudden, SK regained control.
All right, so look at the fight. We see the teleport coming in. Whirlip is not reacting yet. He's waiting for a wall to teleport on. He's going in very late, so Rydal gets all the focus now. Once he's about to be killed, that's when the rest of Giants really start joining in. Whirlip comes in, doesn't kill Enraged, and it's just very messy from a bit of a late TP and then randomly kind of being caught out. And obviously a Jax, we said this before, a Maokai versus a Jax in a team fight will always be heavily in favor of the Maokai compared to what he brings. Simply just a poor team fight when you don't even have to, because you're the one with the split pushing advantage. And obviously Enraged gets smack in his face here, but play the split pushing game. That's how you're gonna win if you're Giants.
Well, you touched on it as well. What is Rek'Sai gonna do in a, you know, four-man defense while Whirlip is split pushing? The answer was not a lot. Frederick got caught out, and SK, all of a sudden, even up the goal. They've got Baron. They've got some pushing power might to help defend against the theoretical split push that Giants could put down. Just like that, 25 minutes of positive, strong play from Giants is undone. And it's SK that can regain control of this map.
Yeah, now we're getting to that point where Tristana, if she ever gets to a tower, it's going to take her just a few seconds to burn it down from a given side. And she's still a strong late game carry as well, obviously. So SK Gaming are looking great. You're going to have that Maokai diving on to Audrey. Jax can kill a carry, but won't be able to soak up the same amount of damage. That's going to be the big difference between these two top laners in the late game. As long as Forgiven plays it safe and like jumps out, or Enraged is there to help him and lock down the Jax, Whirlip will die fairly fast to a late game Tristana.
You know, something else we also have to touch on is that SK played from behind. SK were down in gold. They were falling behind, but they pushed all the towers. Traditionally, when SK's been down at this stage, they've not been punished. Despite all the positive plays, you know, SK are showing a little bit of growth. Ooh. Don't know if it would have killed him, but the heal does come in, and Enraged stays alive to fight another day.
It does mean Enraged has to be very careful here. One hit on him, and he's gonna drop dead. Whirlip is pushing, he has no TP, so Giants is giving up this dragon here. They can do it because they got the first one, or they got the one beforehand, so there's no like fourth dragon suddenly for escape, but they gotta get that tower, at least some damage on it. Freddy's gonna move up there now. So you see how they're pushing mid and top instead of going for dragon? to force Freddy to decide where am I going to defend. Obviously, Jax is the one you got to hold.
Well, Freddy is going to jump up top, hold Wurlib off as best as he can. The rest of SK dealing with the minions in the middle lane. There is some support coming from Enrated as well as Svenskeren, but Giants are in the river. That's a flash from Freddy. He really wants this one. He's gone in with the Vengeful Maelstrom. The rest of Giants seem to have backed off for the time being. Frederick's going to be late to this fight as Rydal is jumping in. The bubble throws Wurlib up in the air, and now Frederick has joined. It's going to be a kill onto Wurlib as Frederick is in full retreat. Dark Binding will connect, and that's a flash away from Frederick. Giants seemed late, despite the fact they were barreling up through the river, and SK do get themselves their 8th kill of the game. Onto the split pushing Jax.
And got that dragon as well, really the big deal for them. So the game is far from over in any way. Very close here between teams. So it's really been all about SK and just punishing Giants for every mistake they've made the last few minutes. This one as well. You're the one setting up the split push, you're the one abandoning the dragon. You should be in a position to join in if the Jax gets jumped, but they were not. And instead it was SK picking up a kill. You see, like, look at the gold here from Giants.
It's just taking off.
And just in the very, very end, SK Gaming gets the lead.
Yeah, it's just really smart play. That team fight, you know, that team fight about, what was it, 5 minutes ago in the middle lane. SK punishing Giants. And you know what, actually, if you step back and look at the league as a whole, Giants have always done well in the laning phase. You know, I think back to the matches against Fnatic in particular. They read Rain over like a book. They had counter ganks, they were in the right place. But the problem for Giants has always been after the laning phase.
Yeah.
They seem to fall to pieces. They seem to just unravel. And the early game and the planning and the prep seems to be in place for, you know, one of the newest LCS squads. But unfortunately, as it's shown, they just get caught out. Wurlib has got some good damage onto Freddy. Did you see the Buster Shot knocks him away? That's a wild growth onto Frederick, and Wurlib jumps back in. The tank is down. Wurlib forced to flash away as Svenskeren eats some rockets. Kill on the board for Giants. Will it result further? Dragon's Rage is used there by Svenskeren earlier. Giants commit to the fight. They get a kill.
Yeah, SK Gaming's turn here to make a bit of a mistake. LeBlanc was in the side lane. Giants saw the opportunity and jumped in. Oh. Slow didn't connect, but Frederick, he's coming.
Oh, bubbled a little bit too early, and Rated is out as the tidal wave gets thrown across the Giants roster. Two kills for Giants. What will that equal? Dragon is not up. A minute and a half till Baron, and it looks like Giants set their sights on that mid tower.
Yeah. Only thing they can really get here, minions are pretty far away, however, so gotta wait for them. Same goes for Paper and Arrow, but just a few good kills for them. They saw the split push had started. There was an opening to go for a 5v4, jumped for it, killed Freddy first, and Reddit joined him after. So I like that little setup for Giants, just getting some gold back.
Yeah, and I think it's important to note, the defense of that inner turret cost Freddy his teleport. So Wurlib now has the teleport advantage.
Should have a Blade as well.
As the split pushing threat, and there you go, Blade of the Rune King completed. So Giants, use your split push power if you want to regain control.
Just put him bottom lane now. Because if SK Gaming goes down to try and kill him like they did before with two or three guys, Giants can run straight to the Baron. And that's really how you want to use this Jax at this point. And then you have Frederick who can take control of the top side in terms of the wave management with his ulti. And you still have this Jinx who's sitting on a static shift. You got the Lulu, so you got great wave play in the mid lane. You got great disengage with Morgana and Lulu to control the map basically like that. But now, though, it looks like Wurlib is just running around the mid lane. Just take the wave bottom lane here. We have TP ready. Not a whole lot of hard engage on the side of SK. It's going to be a righteous lower Maokaj, so you have time to react and, like, teleport in before the real fight breaks out.
Yeah, well, Wurlib's last teleport was particularly late. There was no wards down for him to jump onto, and that cost Giants their control early. Even on gold, even on towers. A couple extra kills for Giants, but they don't have presence or even real vision in this Baron pit. So Giants making the play. Wurlib, Black Shield has been popped. Grandmaster's Might is out. Rydal will be the first one to fall before Soul Shackles can even get proc. Wild Growth onto the Giant Jax. He's looking for Fox. Svenskeren is going to zone them away. We see a trade, one for one. Jungle for top. Morgana was already down. And where is Forgiven? Untouched in the back line. Audrey's still looking for more. The fight goes one for two. But Giants need to be careful. They gave up Baron after not looking to defend it last time around. They seem to have learned from that mistake.
Yeah, staying here. TP already blown by Wurlib. Could have saved that one and just start running back, seeing as SK Gaming hadn't even started their Baron here. I guess they didn't have any vision on it, so that's why he tried. But now, he's dead.
Not a whole lot to say about that one. After you knew they'd fallen. And Pip, look at the play cam. Look at, I mean, Pepe Nero's crushed. He got dropped and absolutely threw his hands up in despair. Giants have given up their second Baron after two massive misplays.
Basically, yeah. Nothing really else to say here from Giants. It looked so good in the early game. But simply the shot call and the decision making is not working for them. And that allows SK Gaming to get the lead back. This one, trying to stop with potential dragon, but remember that TP from Whirlip just kind of wasted before as well on trying to stop that Baron. Oh well, this Baron that never happened.
Yep.
Trying to stop and then Morgan ended up dying. I think what he was trying to do, so they didn't have any wards on the Baron itself. Let's just talk about that after, because now Frederick's trying to steal here. Has to back away, but there's no wards on the Baron. I'm not sure if scrying up was on cooldown for Adrian or not, but if they didn't know if SK were doing it, he teleported in to run in trying to stop it. And then once he realized they were not on it, he wanted to place a ward in the tri-bush to see if SK Gaming had left, like recalled and start a potential Baron from Giants. You got a Jinx, you got a Jax, you can take it down extremely fast. So he was basically looking to see if SK had recalled or not. Had they recalled, there could have been a Baron for Giants, seeing as they were still staying around, knowing, okay, we're not going to just give a free Baron. It ended up in more kills for SK.
So SK Gaming down at 20 minutes, managing to turn their fortune around thanks to a great team fight in the mid lane and then following it up with some very, very decisive Baron plays. And of course, calling out the elephant in the room, punishing mistakes from Giants. The split pushing monster of Jax has not been allowed to split push. That's a defensive flash from Rival. Oh. SK set up in the middle lane.
He's had plenty of openings.
Yep.
Just decided not to take them. But we still do see from SK. I mean, they are number one in the standings in Europe. They got into, they went into IEM and we looked at them and said, okay, they should be able to make it out of groups. I mean, you're here, you've been so good in the ULCS. It's still not been a good game for them. It was an easy game, I think we can say. They've struggled against Giants in the early game. Now they've managed to come back in the game itself. But this is not the SK game we're used to seeing. They're still trying to change up that playstyle their team are trying to take away from them. Now they got into late game. We know Forgiven is an absolutely insane carry, so I trust him on a late game hyper carry more than anyone. And that's why SK Gaming can play this style, but then the early game has to go a lot better for them.
Yep, that's definitely the case. If a team like Giants is able to punish early game, and we've made a few misplays. Giants not had the strongest showings all year long. We did see that Wild Growth was forced from Freddy. Whirlev is trying to jump in. There is an exhaust in him. He's forced out of the fight. It's Forgiven. Blows him up with an explosive charge. Frederick is going to get another massive shield from Pepe Nero, but it won't be enough to save his life. Fox sets his sights on Rylal, but it's Forgiven that tastes the blood. Now he's jumping onto Audrey. Auto attack after auto attack. Pepe Nero's down. Rocket jump forward. Forgiven's looking for the ace. He finds the ace. SK Gaming drop Giants and set their sights on the base. Just hop off the hop, reset off the reset. That is what Forgiven likes about a Tristana, that mobility that he gets from those dashes and jumps.
We just saw it, how easy it was for him in the fight here. Okay, Jax jumps in, everyone just focuses. Five man, he has no real defensive items yet, just picked up the cowl for him. Now, focus that man down fast, you get the first kill, you move on.
Oh, look at this. How many towers can they get?
Tristana.
Nexus turret is dropped. Giants are just respawning now, but it's going to be too late. SK have dropped the Nexus turrets, and they've set their sights on the Nexus. One team fight, and you're done. SK hold on to the top of the standings.
Got Forgiven to the late game. We had all these talks about Maokai Jax against each other. Obviously, the Maokai is going to win out in terms of team fighting, and that's exactly what happened for the last 20 minutes. Teamfight after teamfight, SK Gaming got back in the game, got the lead. Forgiven got to become a late game hyper carry. And SK Gaming picks up another win. Bounce it back, I guess we can say.
That is fair to say. Going 1-2 at IEM, you know, we talked so heavily and so often about the Lulu, the Graves, the Lucian. And I think a little bit of growth in SK's playstyle. You know, putting Freddy on this mega tank, different style of AD carry from Forgiven in terms of the way you execute in-game.
Different style, yeah, but the same forgiven.
Yes, same forgiven.
412 CS on 37 minutes.
Interesting to note, forgiven's only been down in CS at 20 minutes in four games. This split, this was the fourth. And ironically, when he was down, he actually won those games. So interesting to note. Not that it really matters, because he more than made up for it by the end of the match. But yeah, SK, again, back to the drawing board. There are some things to talk about. There are some things to look at. For Giants, on the other hand, that loss means they are tied with MYM. They are tied for the 10th position, and they are 1-1 in the head-to-head. So we may have a tiebreaker. There are still three games to play. There are still things to happen. MYM looking better. Giants, still the same problems.
Still the same problems, and just a very annoying game to lose, because you didn't. You had the early game, you won it, your jacks had become bigger and bigger, you could start split pushing, and then you simply didn't use it. That's the problem, because they could have won this game easily, honestly. They played well early on. So now you're going to look at this in the schedule and say, that was one of the games we didn't expect to do well in, but we did anyway, and we didn't get a win. Now we have Rocket tomorrow. If they lose that game, they're almost out of hopes of getting out of relegation. And this is a team who always talk about how staying in the LCS is the only goal they have. They want to be here for summer. Yeah. They want more practice. They want more time in the gaming house to improve as a team. It's looking scary for them, at least right now.
It really, really is. And the scary thing is, their mid to late game decision making is what is costing Giants. You know, we consistently talk about their laning phase. There is also quite a big weakness, I think, in their picks and bans. They don't have the most versatile players. There is a big difference between Giants, you know, tier one pick performances and tier two picks. So as a squad, they need to work on both their mid to late game decision making as well as upping their level, because Pepe Nero, he's the only one that's showing consistency across a multitude of champions, I feel.
Yeah, and it's going to be hard for him to fix this mid to late game because it's so hard to suddenly find, oh, you're going to be the shot caller, you're going to do great. That's not how it works. I remember talking to Rydell about, you know, the communication on the team. He said, well, everyone kind of provides information, and then we kind of have to make a decision on the spot between five guys saying five different things. And that's why it can go really wrong, because they all have different opinions. And then it's so tough, because you can't just assign one guy to be the shot caller all of a sudden in near the end of the split. That should have been done beforehand if they felt like they had problems communicating or problems with the decision-making for them. So I don't see how they're going to fix this issue in the remaining games. I don't think they will. I think they're going to have to rely on winning that early game and just try and completely snowball it out of control and not get in these situations where suddenly it's a 50-50 fight and they end up losing it because they have a weaker setup. Again, when you pick a Jax into Maokai, you want a split push, nothing else.
Well, it's a battle for survival now. You know, with Giants, they are now 4-11 on the split. Two games behind Rocket, as far as the wins are concerned. The complete opposite end of the spectrum. SK Gaming are now 12 wins, 3 losses. So they've got an extra loss avoided than Fnatic. So SK have still got this tiny buffer to maintain control of first place. For Giants, 3 games left, or they run the risk of dropping down to 10th position and going to auto-relegation. So guys, our analysts will definitely have something to say about SK's win. Let's check in with Shox and Cyanide.
Thank you very much, guys. We're not alone, of course. We're joined by SK Gaming's Enrated, whose team is still alone at the top of the tables halfway through week 8. Of course, I want to talk to you about picks and bans, because there's been a lot of talk from us as well about banning out the Graves and the Lucian. You must have seen it coming, and how did you react to it in this game?
So we kind of try to develop a strategy where we have 3 top picks available, and we just try to like kind of get into the role and create a new top pick. That was in this case Maokai. So when Kog'Maw was out, Maokai was really hard to contest in a way, because whenever Maokai is in the game and there's no like hyper carry available that you can play against it, just the Kog'Maw could have shredded it, and any other AD is just struggling getting through all that HP.
So do you think it hurts you so much that when Lucian and Graves are banned, because you don't get to snowball the bot lane in the same way and like extend your lead from that to every other lane?
I guess there was some kind of strategizing problem in that way. We had more prepared also for IEM, but we didn't show it. I think that was just a mistake of our side, and we should have already picked, for example, Tristana earlier, just to like kind of avoid the whole situation.
Yeah, you do mention IEM. That's where that Graves Lucian thing came from, as well as the Lulu, well, focus or taking it away. This time, you guys, though, you let it through when you went for your Nami. Is that something you wanted to prove, or just, you know, be comfortable with knowing that in the future you might have that Lulu picked away a lot of times?
No, we never felt that Lulu was any problem for our team, at least. We felt more like, because of the AD diversity, I think there were not many ADs similar to Lucian and Graves available at all. And while a lot of supports, we played way more supports in scrims, we didn't actually play Lulu almost at all. But we fell back to it in like tournament situations because we felt there's so much power behind it. And you also saw it at IM, a lot of other supports picked it up in the end. I just feel like we have a lot more to show, and whatever they ban, we will handle it this way.
Yeah, you do mention that whatever they ban out with the AD carries now, as Cyan I touched on as well, it was a little bit harder for you in the early game. Do you think that you can remedy getting better in the early game fast enough in time for playoffs, knowing that you'll be facing teams that are better in the early game than Giants, and better especially in closing it out mid with a lead?
Yeah, I think we had a lane that was not supposed to win in general. I think there was at best a 50-50, if not a bit more in their favor. So what we did was we were trying hold to onto our CS lead and just try to snowball it from there. And we felt like the Sana mid-game is not the strongest, while Jinx kind of has a bigger power spike in that sense. But Tristana just like has a higher ceiling when it comes to late game. So all we did was just waiting out for Tristana to like hit the point where she was really hitting hard. And that's what we did. I think just keeping a CS lead, getting a CS lead is enough, even against good enemies, just to get Tristana rolling.
All right. Well, funny you mentioned that, because Forgiven was actually down in CS by 20, but he picked it up right after and made it work. So it is testament to how you guys like to play. Congratulations. Good on you picking it back up after IEM, of course, as well.
Thank you.
All right, with only 3 games left for each team this split, here's how the standings lie. Alone in first is SK Gaming, with Fnatic just a win behind them. H2K rounds up the top 3, with Gambit a few games back in fourth. Elements are now alone in seventh, just 1 win behind the second place playoff spot. And Meet Your Makers have tied Giants in last place, refusing to go into relegation without a fight. A lot of crazy stuff here today. For me, definitely MYM coming out on top was one of it. What was interesting to you today?
Yeah, MIM was, of course, a slight surprise, but Gambit's performance at IM, not really the best, so it was kind of to be expected. Also, Elements coming strong today, actually playing a really good game, just double tank and running in, even though their warding was worse than H2K's, but they just worked out the problem by just engaging and crushing them in fights. Like, you don't need wards if you just destroy them.
Yeah, that's a good point. Now, with day one of week 8 coming to a close, we have to recognize a player that packed up their bags and carried harder than the rest. With 6 kills, 11 assists, and a 89.5 kill participation, our fantasy LCS points leader is the one and only Huni with 32 points. A great game from him once again, and cool to see him on another champion than the ones we expected from him.
Yeah, Hecarim was definitely a pleasant surprise, although not so pleasant because now people will play it even more in solo queue. It's completely disgusting to play against, but still happy to see him do so well.
Make sure you get that on your team. Now, Elements' Fragon also put on a show today, and at Stank Vicious took notice. He writes, "Super Mega Death Requiem. This is your LCS big play of the day."
Did you see the Prey Seeker going up? Box has already been used. Teleport coming down. Follows up from the Requiem.
Oh,
the Mega Death Rocket gets one.
Beautiful setup. Ulti from Froggen into Reckless here with the big rocket.
Yeah, from at Stank Vicious. I actually worked with Stank Vicious a couple of times. It actually smells quite nice, so I don't know if that's accurate. And anyway, keep sending in those plays by tweeting at LOL Esports with the hashtag LCS Big Plays, and we'll check out some more of your favorites tomorrow. Now, tomorrow also brings the conclusion of Week 8, starting with Meet Your Makers versus H2K. The Unicorns of Love will face Fnatic, SK Gaming will take on the Copenhagen Wolves, and we'll end the day with Elements versus Gambit Gaming, a key match for Froggen & Co. if they want a shot at the playoffs, and honestly, I think they can take it.
Yeah, if they play like they did today, they have a good shot. Just a solid strategy, and like I said, if you win the team fights, it doesn't matter in the end what else happens.
Yep, we will see. Our coverage continues tomorrow at 6 p.m. Central European time, and until daylight savings time kicks in here, that is 10 a.m. Pacific. Now, sadly, we have to sign off until then, but for myself, our guest Cyanide, and the entire broadcast team, thank you for tuning in, and we'll see you back here in Berlin tomorrow.
We're back into week 8 now. Every game counts. I'm really excited to see what happens here.
Oh, there is going to be a big combo as JWoww comes up with a pick, a teleport in for Cabo Shard, leading the charge in. It's Diamond, but do they have the damage to take him out? The Wild Growth to keep him alive, but not for long. And Meet Your Makers could still make the playoffs. Yeah, he's isolated, actually. He's going to dodge out the skill shots. The chains are on him, however. Timbers is dropped, but so is Yellowstar. Rainover bouncing all around. And Fnatic, a dominating performance over Rocket.
I can flash. I'm coming. Karthus, Sivir,
Lulu. Yeah, Karthus has still ult.
I lifesteal.
You need to have Valis.
And the Unicorns of Love have taken the win.
What is the sign saying? I cannot read it.
I mean, Liv, go over everything again.
He's turning away.
Liv.
The other one says, Welcome, League of Elements.
Oh god.
Where everybody else is trash.
Still alive on the back line as Ryu forced to go back to a clone. Kasing is the first one to drop as the tower takes out Froggen. But Requiem should get more. What can HTK do? Wicket's gone in. His five members on top of each other. The Mega Gnar throws everyone back. Elements dropping their eight-game winning streak and keeping their playoff hopes alive.
But oh, Super Mega Death.
Set his sights on Rylal, but it's forgiven. That tastes the blood. Now he's jumping onto Audrey. Auto attack off the auto attack. Pippa Nero's down. SK hold on to the top of the standings.